of Christ Reformed Church. I'm Pastor Ferguson. It's great to be gathered together in the name of the Lord. And then I'm going to turn this fan down so you can hear me better. Okay, hopefully that's a little better. I think last week's sermon was a little hard to hear because of that. I forgot to turn that fan on. At any rate, it's good to be gathered together again, amen. Well, God is an awesome God, and He is the eternal God. He's always existed. He will never end. He has no beginning and no end. You know, for us to think of that is hard to conceive. It's a being that has no beginning, just always existed. That's just hard to wrap your mind around. But that's the God that we serve. That's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, David, and the rest. And we can trust in Him. But you know, life has its circumstances. God sends those circumstances our way in order to test us, to try our faith, you know, to see how much we love Him, and how little we love Him, I should say. Our tests and trials and circumstances reveal that to us. Everything belongs to the Lord. The Bible says that God owns the cattle on a thousand hills, the beast of the forest are His, the earth, the ocean, the sky, the stars, the moon, the sun, you and I, every man, woman, child, animal, creature, alive, not alive, the rocks, the mountains, they all belong to God. What is man? He thinks He owns these things, but you know, God has His way of proving that He doesn't own them, because when He dies, He can't take them with Him. So, you know, what's the point in gathering up, you know, millions and billions of dollars of land, owning all this land? Can't keep it. You can't take it with you, so you don't really own it. If you owned it, you could take it with you. But because we don't own anything, we can't take anything with us. And so today I want to talk to you about keeping your mind on God. It's one thing to say you believe in God, say you're a Christian, but it's another thing to put it into practice. It's one thing to read the Bible, but it's another thing to memorize the Bible, to always have the Bible on your mind. You know, you don't want to be like a double-minded man, as James speaks of, who reads the Word, but then immediately forgets it. What good is that if you just read it and forget it? You can't keep your mind on God if you forget the Word of God. The Spirit of God works through the Word of God. And that's how we grow in Christ. It's through the Spirit of God working through the Word of God. We can't see God with our physical eyes, but we can see Him by faith. And we see Him move obstacles in our life. We see Him protect us and our loved ones and His children. And we see all that. We see Him change people's hearts and lives. That's seeing God by faith, not by sight, although the results you can see by sight, but you can't see God himself by sight. You can see the work of his hands. You can see what he's doing in a person's life. You can see the effects that his word has on your life, on my life, on other people's lives. But God himself, we cannot see because he's a spirit. Now Christ, he is God incarnate. So the people who lived with Christ in Christ's time, they actually saw God, because Christ was God. And they didn't acknowledge him as God because they were carnally minded. Not until the end, until after he rose again, then they acknowledged him. And they knew who he really was. And throughout his life, for the most part, very few people acknowledged him as the Messiah, as God. There were very few, just a small handful. So, at any rate, let us go to God in a word of prayer before we get started. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we come to you this day. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you and praise you for all that you are, all that you've done, and all that you continue to do in our hearts and in our lives. Forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all iniquity, creating us clean hearts and renew right minds within us. We just thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for reaching out and redeeming us from our sins, for choosing us before the foundation of the world, giving us an inheritance that is incorruptible. God, it's our prayer and desire that we can keep our hearts and our minds stayed on you throughout life's circumstances, throughout the vicissitudes of life, and all the temptations and trials that we face and must deal with. Lord, if we could just keep our mind and our eyes, our spiritual eyes, focused on you, we know we would fare much better. We would come forth as gold, as Job said, when we have been tried, that we will come forth as gold. And that's our desire, to be gold, to be shining gold, that the world might see you in us. They might see your reflection, even as the moon reflects the light, that we might reflect your light, your word, to the world. They might know and understand and want to have a relationship with you. Lord, we just thank you for choosing us. We thank you for your love and kindness and patience. Teach us, Lord, how to keep our minds and our hearts and our spiritual eyes stayed on you. We ask in Christ's name. So where else do we turn, as Jesus asked the disciples, who do you say that I am? Of course, Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. To whom else shall we turn? After the rest of the people forsook him, in John chapter 6, he made some hard statements, saying, no man can come unto me unless the Father draw him. He said, many walked with him no more after they heard that. But the disciples said, to whom else shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. Jesus is the Word of God. And we need to turn to him all the time. There's so many distractions in the world. The TV, the phone, the iPhone. We can easily become distracted. All the material things and cares and whatnot of this world. But I want to turn our attention to Isaiah 26 and verse 3. You've probably heard it before. It's a great, powerful verse. Make plaques and stuff out of it. Because there's love power. Isaiah was a love power in the Word of God. Any of the Word of God is, it is power, it's a sword. But this particular verse here stands out. And let me just read it for you. It says that, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in thee. He trusted. Perfect peace. Now, isn't that what you desire? Isn't that what I desire? Yeah, perfect peace. Perfect peace. To be unmoved from the world, from the devil, the flesh. You know, the flesh has a way of moving us off of our path, off of the calling that God has called us to. Has a way of getting our minds off of God. When you are tempted, then your mind is off God. You are looking at the temptation. Jesus, of course, battled the temptation with the Word of God. That's what we need to do. He said, not my will, but thine be done. He struggled in the Garden of Gethsemane against temptation. He cried out to his Father to deliver him from that hour. So let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. You know, that's really what it boils down to, isn't it? As a Christian, it's not doing your own selfish, fleshly, carnal will and desires, but doing the perfect will of God, executing holiness in the fear of God. Then you're doing His will, not your own. When you do His will, then you have perfect peace, as the prophet Isaiah says. How else can you do His will except by keeping your mind on Him? And you cannot do His will unless you have your mind on Him. So when you're faced with temptation, whatever it may be, you're faced with an ultimatum of either placing your mind on that temptation and entertaining it. You know, there's an old saying that sin fascinates and then it assassinates. So, and that's true. It does fascinate, like the forbidden fruit. It fascinated Eve. So it fascinated Adam too, but then it assassinated them. So sin always fascinates before it assassinates. And we have to be wary of that. We've got to be leery. And the devil, it says he prowls around, excuse me, as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may to devour. He's up to no good. He just wants to, distract and hurt and watch God's children defeat themselves. And that's what we do, is he cannot defeat us. But when we, he's been defeated on the cross by Christ, but when we succumb or we submit ourselves to that which he presents to us, when we partake of the forbidden fruit, then we allow him to win the battle. The war has already been won. Jesus won the war on the cross. It's already set in stone. And I believe that the devil knows his end is at hand. He knows he is defeated. But he has so much time to challenge God, to challenge God's children. And we need to make a point to not allow him to get the upper hand. We have the upper hand because we belong to Christ. So the goal here is keeping your mind on Christ. There's a story in the Gospels about Peter and Jesus walking on water. And it says that in the fourth watch of the night, they saw Jesus walking on the water. And they thought he was a ghost. But Peter, he recognized the Lord, so it kind of looks like the Lord. And the closer he got, Peter, he says, "Lord, if it be you, bid me come unto you. If it's you, bid me, command me to come. I want to walk on water too." Don't you just love Peter? I mean, he had great faith. And he knew that if the Lord could do it, then he should be able to do it. He knew the Lord had that kind of power. And of course, Jesus says, "Come." Peter gets out of the boat, and boy, he's walking on the water. You know, everything is miraculous. And walking on water, I mean, how can you walk on water? Only God could enable you to do that. But it says that he saw the wind. It was boisterous. He looked at the wind. Well, you can't see the wind, but he was afraid. He became afraid. And he felt the wind. Then he took his eyes off the Lord and began looking around at his troubles. I'm in the middle of the ocean. And I'm not on a boat. I don't have any security under me. What's going to happen? Well, I'm going to sink. And that's exactly what he began to do. Because he didn't keep his eyes on the Lord. You and I, when we're faced with temptation, if we don't run to the Lord, to the Word of God, Spirit of God in prayer, then we're going to sink. We're going to succumb to the temptation, to the trial. We're going to break and cave in. The devil, he always wants us to break.
It's his goal
to break us so that we cave in during the test, during the trial. And I'm here to tell you, by the authority of God's Word, that We not only should not cave in and to the lust of the flesh, we not only should not, but we cannot. We have the ability not to. The world doesn't have the ability. The world that is not saved, they are always caving in to the lust of their flesh. Oh, they might look virtuous on the outside, but when they get home, when they get behind closed doors, they're going to entertain the lust of their flesh, I guarantee you that. They're going to give vent to those carnal desires and appetites. There's nothing to restrain them. They don't have the Holy Spirit to fight them off. But we do. We've been sealed. Corinthians says, know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, whom ye have from God, that ye are not your own, for ye have been bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. The body belongs to the Lord. It's not your own. Did you know that? Your body, your eyes, nose, hands, feet, legs, arms, everything about you belongs to the Lord. You're not your own. You didn't create yourself. You don't own yourself. Belong to the Lord. So therefore, we need to be good stewards of this body, which is the temple where God dwells in the body. Okay. There's really, it boils down to good stewardship. What are you going to do with your eyes? I say your eyes, but in one sense they are your eyes, but they don't belong to you. You're borrowing them, so to speak. You're going to have to give an account of what you did with your eyes, the words that you spoke with your mouth. You're going to have to give an account of the things that we did with these hands that don't belong to us. You understand? The feet, the eyes, the mouth, the ears. They don't belong to us. We are simply stewards of them. Are you a good steward? Using the body to the glory of God? Or are you a wicked and poor steward? Using the body for your own flesh and lust. That's what we need to ask ourselves. So back to my original point of keeping our minds on God. How do we do it? Well, it's a good question. There's a simple answer. But it is committing ourselves Word of God. The Word of God has to be a priority. You know, in the Old Testament, the priest, the high priest, he would have the Word of God tied around his head. It said, holiness unto the Lord. Loving the Lord thy God with all thy heart, my soul, and strength requires keeping your mind on the Word of God. You can't have it any other way. Some people run around saying, I love God, I love Jesus, but I don't need the Bible. That's nonsense. That's like saying you love somebody and you don't want to hear from them. They call and you won't answer the phone. Or you won't call them. Yeah, what kind of relationship is that? It's not. Run around telling people you love them, but you don't want to hear from them. That's called laziness. That's called neglect. That's called seeking another way to God. There is no other way except through the Word of God. The Word of God conveys the mind of God. He whose mind is stayed on the Word of God, that will keep him in perfect peace. And the Word of God is a part of God. Jesus is the Word. His Spirit is in the Word. He himself said, "My word, the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." So if you keep your mind on the Word of God, you keep your mind on God. Now we can't see God, we can see His Word. His Word is enough, isn't it? Imagine a family relative, your dad, goes on a long trip. You can't see him anymore. But he sends you letters, or text messages. You can read those, and you should, because he loves you, and he loves you. And you cherish those letters. You keep them in a safe place. Right? Because they are part of him. I said God's Word is a part of Him. We should never neglect it. Bible before breakfast. That's how I live. You ought to try it sometime. You know, spiritual food is more important than physical food. Physical food, it just feeds the physical body. Spiritual food, the Word of God, feeds the soul, feeds the spiritual man. The more we read of it, the more we listen to it, that's what I like to do, is listen to it while I'm driving. I'd rather listen to the Word of God than listen to music. It's more powerful, it's more therapeutic to the soul. Music kind of caters to the flesh, but the Word of God caters directly to the new man created in Christ, to your soul in Christ. So, you notice that it says, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace." God does the keeping. You don't keep yourself. You can't save yourself. You can't even sanctify yourself. Both of those are a work of the Holy Spirit. God will keep you in perfect peace. God is the one. He does the keeping. You and I have to do is keep our minds on the Word of God. When our minds are on the Word of God, then God will keep us in perfect peace. How can it be any otherwise? How can it be any otherwise? How can it be otherwise? Can't. So that is the goal, and the way we get there is by reading the Word of God daily, habitually, memorizing Scripture. Now, if you forget what you read, go back to it. Burn it in your mind again and again and again until you're always thinking about the Word of God. That's what we have. That's what God has given us, is His Word. And we can see it. We can read it. We can love it. We should love it. And believe it. And take hold of it. Yes, we commune with God in spirit throughout the day. Always be praying. That's another way of keeping your mind on God. Praying. Right? When you're praying, your mind has to be on God. Who are you praying to? If your mind is on the world when you're praying, you're not praying. You're just playing games. But when you're really praying, then your mind will be directly on God. You're communing with God. He has your attention. So Bible study and prayer will keep our minds on God. Not difficult to do. It just requires a little effort and discipline. Both of which we have from God. Effort is a gift of God. He bestows that. He stirs us up to seek after Him. We've been given a spirit of self-control, discipline. Put it into practice. And I guarantee you, the trials that you're going through will be much easier to bear when your mind is on the Word of God, when your mind is in prayer to God. Burden will be lifted. God will make a way through the mighty waters. He'll part the Red Sea and the Jordan so you can cross over. Okay. So the things that keep our, that get our minds off of God are things like television, the phone, the internet. God knows we need to use those things for research and information. Maybe occasional entertainment is okay. Just don't overdo it. As long as it's clean, not dirty, provocative. Certain things will definitely pull our minds off of God. Provocative, dirty shows and websites and stuff like that. You don't want to go there. You know who's in charge of those. Not God, the devil. Yeah, he's going to get your attention. He's going to fascinate you before he assassinates you. And then you're going to wish you hadn't have gone there. So if we're in a spirit of prayer, we won't go there. Lead us and guide us away from temptation. Not to temptation, but through temptation. That's the goal. Okay? I hope this helps. It's my prayer and desire. Keep our hearts and minds stayed on God, the things of God, the spirit of prayer. Be victorious. Get the victory. You can do it one day, you can do it two. If you can do it two, you can do it a week. If you can do it for a week, you can do it a month, and a year, and 5 years, 10, 20, and so on. Until the Lord takes us out. If you want that perfect peace, then you got to keep your mind on this book and in the spirit of prayer. nothing will move you. Don't get it off the Lord, otherwise you're going to be moved. You'll be tossed to and fro. Amen. May God bless us in our prayer. In Jesus' name.